theories.
Yeah.
Because there's actually a good number of theories, though they're all pretty interlinked, but...
They're kind of like small variants in one another.
Still a little bit.
Yeah.
So, theory number one is...
UFOs.
Not UFOs.
Oh. Chupacabra.
Yeah.
Or, well, actually, you know what?
Could be. Mexico.
Could be.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what? Never steal coke from a chupacabra.
For real, though.
Dude.
That's a bad idea.
Grudge. Mm-hmm. Lifetime grudge. And by lifetime, I mean your short remaining amount of lifetime.
Because
he can get
you. You're our man.
All right, so let's get back to reality here, which is that the theory is that Palomeque was murdered by a cocaine dealer and or a drug cartel.
A.K.A. the chupacabra.
Yes.
Of course.
So... We talked about the fact that he had a penchant for cocaine, apparently, according to the reporting.
Sure.
And when you like to do lots of drugs, you end up hanging out with the people who supply you those drugs. And those don't tend to be the most reputable people around.
Often the case.
So the theory goes that Palomeque, he's hanging out with these people. He pisses off the wrong person, presumably a drug dealer, and my guess would be that this would have had to have happened in Mazatlan, and that dealer, that angry drug dealer, then says that you're going to get it, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to get you for this, which is what prompts him to leave town quite quickly on a bus, and what prompts him then to have his panic attack or freak out and get off of the bus and send this panicky text to his wife? I don't know. I mean, it's possible that maybe the guy was also texting him, though I've never found any records of that. His wife has never provided anything that supports this at all.
I suppose his phone was in his pocket when he was found, and probably it was wet, and they probably couldn't really restore anything.
I would presume that would be the case. There's no mention of where his phone was recovered. That's another interesting fact.
His phone may have never actually been recovered.
Yeah.
Yeah. You might have dropped it and lost it somewhere. But
he may very well. But
I have a few theories on this one.
Okay. Well, let me finish just the theory itself, or do you want to push him in now?
Go ahead.
Okay. So basically, this theory is that he's in contact with this drug person. I know this sounds silly, but drug person. And that freaks him out. He gets off the bus. Somehow they find him and either A, shove him off of the bridge into the water, or are on the bank with him and drag him into the water and hold him under the water until he expires.
I just had a couple thoughts.
Okay.
You know, in terms of if somebody was following him or not. Okay, somebody could have been texting him. He could have had an additional phone. If he was doing lots of drugs, he probably had a burner. Right?
Could have been somebody who was on the bus with him.
That was the other thing I was going to say, is it could have been somebody who was on the bus with him, or it could have been that if a drug dealer was thinking, oh, I'm going to kill this guy, he provided him with some less than pure drugs, or some drugs with some laced with something of some kind that he did
to
either right before he got on the bus or while he was on the bus that caused his panic attack. I mean, it's not a direct hand of I literally held this guy's head under the water and killed him, but if you send him into a panic attack on a bus in the middle of nowhere, he's probably going to have a panic attack and somehow find himself dead or otherwise locked up.
I wonder if somebody could have, like, slipped him a little LSD.
Yeah, or, you know, or all you do is you give him bad drugs and then have one of your guys be on the bus with him.
But then,
just to ensure, you know.
But nobody was witness getting off the bus after him.
No, I don't mean that. I mean that, you know, you do your drugs and then you start to slip into this paranoia and you look up and there's one of the guys who is your drug dealer's henchman and you think,
staring at you,
oh my god, I have to get off this bus. So he gets off the bus and nobody follows him, which is fine, but he's still in this panic state of what's gonna happen, I have to get away.
See, the thing about that is that if the henchman is there scaring him, then getting off the bus in the middle of nowhere really makes no sense.
Yeah, I agree with that, but we're not saying that he's, as Steve would say, we're not thinking rational thought here.
Mm.
We're
thinking, thank you. You took it right out of
very
my mouth.
Drugged up thought.
Yeah, there's that. But the other thing, too, is if you're going to send a hit squad out to find him, well, number one, how do you find him out there in the dark? But
you're following the bus. Mm. You're in a car following the bus, and your henchman on the bus says, he just got off. Did you see us stop?
Yeah.
It's true, yeah.
Although, if I was going to go after Abismo Negro, I would have a pretty healthy-sized team.
I would think that they would use weapons. yeah, because, that were not just their hands. Yeah, because the guy...
Unless you've drugged them really well.
True.
But, yeah, Bisto Negro, I don't think we mentioned it. Before he got into wrestling, he was into martial arts big time,
mm-hmm.
too.
So, well, and he's
a big, strong guy.
He's a big, strong guy. He's been doing this for 20 years. That means he's very muscular. He knows how to handle himself. He fights for a living.
Well, mm-hmm. kind of.
Play but he does physical work for a living. He's a big guy.
Yeah.
It's not as if I, as a scrawny 40-year-old guy with a pot belly, is going to run up to him and yell at him, and he's be like, oh, scared of you?
Yeah.
Sorry. He's going to look at me and smack me in the head.
Probably.
And I'm going to have a concussion.
So here's another question. We said it was dry season,
mm-hmm.
but there was this kind of pond area. The shore around this pond area, was it dry or was it wet?
It's a very good question. There's only two images that I could find. Those images seem to indicate that it was kind of a clayish riverbed.
Okay.
And that right up against the water, it is soppy clay.
Mm-hmm.
And then outside of that, it's kind of hard dirt.
Okay. Yeah, that answers my question.
So there should be footprints of some kind.
The hard dirt, it's easy to get rid of footprints. Clay, less wet clay, it's hard, very hard to get rid of them.
Yeah.
But then again, if there are footprints there, that's not necessarily a shocker anyway.
That's true, and also there are enough people out searching that there's nothing to say.
That the scene wasn't swamped.
Right, yeah. And that the first person who was there didn't say, and I noticed there were a lot of footprints around. They would just be like, oh my god, we found him, and everyone could come running and say, oh, we found him, and then...
Yeah, next thing you know, that's when whenever I murder somebody that way, I always bring several sets of shoes along,
mm-hmm.
so I can leave just all kinds of footprints, and, yeah.
Joe is
that's where my shoes have been going.
He does have small feet.
He does. Very
or
petite.
Or you have big feet. One of the two.
Yeah.
let's go on to the next theory, which is that he drowned due to his panic attack or psychosis, which was caused by his use of steroids.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to say this again. We don't know that he was on steroids. But there is so much friggin' talk about it that you can't ignore it.
Well, it occurs to me that it is totally possible, even probable, that the medical examiner came back and said, yeah, he drowned. He was on a lot of steroids and a lot of coke and a lot of other things. And the family said, cool, he drowned.
Yeah, let's see. Yeah, what was
you know, you wouldn't necessarily then publicize, and he was on tons of drugs and he did it to himself. You would probably downplay that as much as possible
he might just say
he drowned.
But yeah, for his dignity.
What were the results of the toxicology report, if one was done?
That's a very good question, Joe. Mm. I never found that because I don't believe it was ever publicized.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
I'm saying it must have been, but yeah.
I mean, it could have been
okay.
done.
Let's back this train up for a second, though. We say one must have been done. We don't know what the standard practice is in this rural, this small area.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not trying to sound like a jerk who's belittling the medical practitioners in Mexico by any way or means, but we also don't know that based on
resources.
Their funding, what is their resources? What do they start with? If they go, the easy thing is, let's open him up. Oh, look, water's everywhere. Done deal. It's easy. I mean, we don't know. And I don't know that, and I don't want to put anything on anybody, but as far as I know, that wasn't done. But let's continue to run down the steroids line.
Yeah, sure.
Because I got a hold of some of our experts, and there's a lot of conflicting information about the psychological effects of anabolic steroids.
Apparently, some of that stuff about roid rage is...
It's a little inflated.
A little bit, yeah.
A little bit inflated.
It's hard because you can't really study it.
That's a good point. And yeah, so here's the deal. On their own, anabolic steroids, which for anybody who doesn't know, that's the thing that guys take to pump themselves up. Pump you up.
Mm-hmm. We're going to pump you up.
Exactly. All right. These are the things that people take to get big, but they do have the potential to cause behavioral changes. And these behavioral changes don't come on suddenly. They're things that build up over time. The side effects, according to the studies, though, these behavioral side effects, only occur in 2-3% of users. But there's a couple of things to point out about the studies, the first of which is that they presume, and in the studies, the users are only using one kind of steroid. Well, turns out guys who are juicing use multiple types at once, and they do what's called pyramiding, where they will go in a, let's say it's a 12-week rotation, so they'll build up for 6 weeks and taper off for 6 weeks. But 2 weeks later, they'll start another kind of steroid. So they're constantly in this cycle with multiple kinds at once. Well, in the studies, because they're clinical studies, they can't do that. That's one thing that's not factored in. The other thing about the studies is that they eliminate people who have a potential psychological issue.
Like a pre-existing one.
Yes.
Yeah, you want blank slates,
right?
Case study. But although, people who do that stuff aren't blank slates.
No!
Yeah.
But therein lies another problem.
But Abismo did he have a history of psychiatric problems?
Not that we know of.
No, but I mean, the other thing that you don't really necessarily take into consideration in studies like this, right? Abismo Negro probably had, like, a couple concussions,
yeah,
right? There was probably a little bit of that sort of thing going on. And we know now from a lot of studies that are being done in America that that can have profound, prolonged, and also delayed effects on your brain and the way that it works.
And
so if you're also doing steroids on top of that...
And then those things can... just systematically get worse and worse and worse.
And then, of course, he stops off in Mazatlanta and snorts about a half a pound of cocaine.
On top of steroids, maybe, and then you're just done. You're done.
Yeah, exactly.
And who knows how pure the cocaine is. Right?
Well, okay. So let's take the coke out of the situation. This theory is not so much centered in the cocaine, but just that, let's say he's at the peak of a pyramid of a cycle of his steroid use. That could have been over the edge.
Yeah.
So then all of this, it all builds up to this psychosis where he suddenly has this breakdown on the bus. The only thing that kind of lends itself possibly to indicate that this could be right is that I said before he was at a match on the 16th, because he had been at the King of Kings match on the 14th or the 15th, whichever it was, and he got knocked out in the first round, and then he goes to this other match, which was, sounded like it was kind of a house match or a town match. I don't, you know, it was just kind of a local event, but he was booked for it. He was despondent is the phrase that I saw used. He was not happy. He was complaining to the other wrestlers. Now, maybe that's, I'm not getting used enough. They're leaving me out because I'm always missing my matches. I mean, I don't know what it is, but people have pointed that and say, well, his behavior was, he was on kind of a downward trend and was about to break.
Well, you know, he was kind of on a downward train there. You know? So, I would be depressed if I were him, too.
Yeah. And so if you follow the finality of this, it says that he had his break. This is, of course, because it's due to the steroids. The steroids caused the break. He then gets off of the bus. He is completely unaware of his surroundings and either wanders into the water and is so unaware that he aspirates water and drowns, or, we've said this before, the water is shallow, like waist-deep shallow. It's entirely possible that he was on the bridge. He wanders over the edge of the bridge and falls over the rail.
How high was the bridge, though?
I would say that bridge was 20, 25 feet high.
What?
Joe, what is that, meters, by the way? That's, what, 10, 15? 10, 12?
Oh, God.
Three, that's 10, 12.
Yeah, yeah,
10,
yeah,
12 okay. meters.
I would, I guess I would say that if you fell face first off of something like that, your face would be pretty mashed up. That'd be something.
I spent a lot of time thinking about this. Let's say he falls off the railing and he lands on anywhere that is not head first, so he is in a prone position when he hits.
You're still going to break, he's bruising. Lots of outward damage will happen from a fall like that.
But not enough that I think that if he's been soaking in the drink for a day, it's going to be super noticeable. And my point is that he would be stunned and then drowned.
Mm.
That's you're right. There should be outward signs, but there's a whole bunch of details of outward signs that we have no record of.
That's fair.
I'm kind of doubting that he fell off the bridge, though. I don't know what the standards are for railings in Mexico, but I assume they're kind of similar to what we have here.
Oh, yeah. No, it's a roadside bridge. It's about waist high.
Yeah.
I mean, I was on Google Maps. I was pulling a Joe. I was on Google Maps doing Street View, and I drove across that bridge, and it's about waist high.
Yeah. So if you seriously want to, you know, get over that, you're going to have to probably do it deliberately. You're not just going to trip and fall off.
Well, you might. The other thing I do want to just point out real quick here is I don't know if you guys have seen this video or not, because I know we're going to talk about more. He was just panicking and drowned theories. There's this video of this little kid who I don't know, I don't remember where he is, but he's like probably 5 or 6 years old, and he's clinging to a rope, floating on his back, like crying because he thinks he's going to drown, until suddenly his older sister or mom or somebody comes over and just kind of pushes his legs down, and it turns out it's been like lower than waist deep, this water, the entire time. But he was so sure, and I've seen this happen to other people too, sometimes you get so sure that you're drowning, you just panic and don't do anything actually helpful. You're just thinking you're drowning.
You
you just seize up, or you start flailing around thinking, oh my God, I'm drowning because my face is covered in water, without thinking, my back is dry though, or I could stand up. You know, if you're entirely submerged, your head is entirely submerged, you're probably just gonna think, I'm drowning. And if you're already having a panic attack or some kind of mental break, you're probably not going to be able to do anything helpful. So I do want to bring that up a little bit.
Yeah. No, so that's
entirely possible.
As we talk
about that, in saying that, yeah, it's only waist deep, but it's still waist deep, and that's enough to submerge your head fully.
So, and I also, I'm going to move a theory that was at the end of this. I'm going to actually shuttle this forward. We're going to talk about this now, which is that let's take the psychological break out of it, okay? It's entirely possible. So I can't explain why he got off the bridge, or off of the bus, excuse me. I can't explain why he got off the bus. But when I talk about the fall bit, it's entirely possible. He's in the dark. It's 1:30 in the morning. He can't see a damn thing.
It's actually well past 1:30 by the time he actually fell into that hole and drowned, probably.
Okay, so it's 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, something. Yeah. It's pitch black out. He can't see crap. And the hole, he fell over the railing. He could have literally been have you ever walked into a wall in the dark and had no idea it was there? He could have been walking and suddenly just pitched over the rail and went down because he had no idea where he was. It's entirely possible. Do I think that's what happened? No. But because we're bringing this up, there in the water line below the bridge, the lip of the bridge where he was found, it's not a straight line. It's kind of an undulating shape.
Yeah.
So he would have either, if he fell off the top of the bridge, he would have either A, hit the water, or B, hit the ground. And I'm pretty sure he didn't hit the ground because there's no impression of his body in the shore. And also, it'd be really hard for him to hit hard enough to bounce into the water.
Yeah.
Which makes me think that he would have hit the water. Which again brings me to, he could have hit just right. We talk about this all the time. The odds of this are phenomenal, but it's possible. Hits just right where it doesn't leave any outward signs, but it stuns him and he drowns.
But also, if you do a belly flop on the water, it's going to knock the wind out of you.
And you're going to suck in.
And you're going to draw air in.
There's and you're going to draw a lot of water in when you do that.
There's also that phenomenon, which I experienced one time rafting, and I don't know how cold that water was, but when you hit really cold water,
I can't imagine it was cold, Joe. It was the dry season.
This was March, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I suppose it wouldn't have been that cold.
It's not freezing cold. Gasp reflex.
It's just a gasp reflex.
Because you hit the water hard. You get the water, the wind knocked out of you.
Yeah. Or you're so stunned, you just like are out of it. You know, damn. I tend to think he just stumbled into it, or maybe fell off the bridge myself.
Yeah. Well, let's keep going though, because we talked about this enough so far, but we got more theories.
Somehow.
Okay. Next theory is that this is related, very similar to the last one. Is that
the one before last?
The one before last? Yeah. Because I moved one up. He drowned. His panic attack or psychosis, whichever it is, was caused by actually not steroids, but steroid withdrawal. Because one of our experts that I was talking with was bringing up the fact that, while the psychosis can happen, it actually is a little more prevalent when somebody goes cold turkey. That's the problem. is you just suddenly get off the sauce. And that might have been what caused him to go off his trolley, as they say, and then get off the bus, be so confused, and whatever happens for him to be end up in the water happens.
Is it steroid withdrawal? What withdrawal is it that makes you really thirsty? Do you know?
Water, I think.
Like, that you need water.
Yeah, if you haven't had water for a couple of days.
Well, I mean, there are certain drug withdrawals.
There are.
That cause you to be really thirsty. Yeah, I'm just wondering if maybe, like, he was going through some withdrawal of some kind and saw this little thing of water and thought, I will drink from that, but was so messed up.
That he just went in.
That he just went in head first.
I don't know. I mean, when he's
that
in
is
this
accidental
state.
Drowning, technically.
Yeah,
so I guess it's technically fair. Yeah, okay.
We're gonna go to the next one, which is very similar again, which is that his panic attack or psychosis was caused by none other than cocaine, because it, like we talked about, he seems to have really enjoyed it. And this is a list of side effects that I found. The short-term side effects of cocaine are anxiety, paranoia, panic, and some other forms of psychosis. And because he's a user of it, he likes it, he would fall into the category of long-term effects. Those would be auditory and tactile hallucinations, otherwise known as hearing things and feeling things on your skin. That's a common description. Disorientation, delirium, and confusion. So, coke bender, jump off bus, fall off bridge, end up in water is kind of the short of what this one is.
Yeah.
And he was probably lost, too, which, like, believe me, is kind of a panicky feeling right into himself.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, in the very dark of night.
Yeah.
And, you know, he had a cell phone, but we don't know if it had a good a flash on it for him to use.
It's 2004, like right?
2009.
Oh.
Okay, so he probably did. He might have had a smartphone, didn't he?
He might have had a smartphone.
But
he might not have.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't know that for sure. Moving on again, we have one last theory, which I actually think, personally, I find to be my preferred theory.
Okay.
Which is that he drowned or fell due to a stroke or a heart attack.
Which is not unusual if you've been doing a lot of coke. Heart attacks are not uncommon.
It's also not unknown or unprecedented when you've been doing steroids, because steroids are known to cause people to have strokes and heart attacks. And this isn't necessarily for heavy users. This is just like casual users who work it into their workout routine and suddenly have it. They just suddenly, with no signs previously, have a stroke, have a heart attack, because they decided they were going to juice. And this happens. By the way, did either of you look up the slang for steroids?
No.
Oh, what slang is that?
The names that it gets? This is the best thing ever. I've said it a couple of times. It's juicing. But they call it juicing, gym candy, pumpers, roids, stackers. And are you ready for it?
Yeah.
Arnold's.
I know. I love this. That's my favorite.
That's my favorite. But
the Schwartzkis.
The Schwartzkis are known for causing heart attacks.
Yeah.
And for causing strokes. So it could have been. Or maybe it was the coke. He's on the bus.
A combination thereof.
He's in the beginning of a heart attack or a stroke, which is known to be a state of delirium.
It's not just delirium. It also causes you to be panicked and uncomfortable.
Yes.
Like, very uncomfortable.
Yes.
And also, oftentimes, like, hot, and you try to escape all of the situations that you're in.
I'm pointing at her with the yes finger.
Yeah, that's the yes finger. Yeah. I mean, you know, both of those. And again, it doesn't necessarily have to be drug-induced. It could have been that it was just a blood clot from an injury.
Mm-hmm.
It could be that he just lived a hard lifestyle. It could be that he was genetically predisposed to that, maybe. But I mean, if it was a small stroke and all it did was really incapacitate him for enough time that he fell into water and also drowned, it's not unreasonable to assume that the ME would miss something like that. In addition to that, also a heart attack.
In a cursory medical examination or a cursory...
Well, yeah, if you see water in the lungs, you're not going to also do an extensive exam of the heart and brain to see if they had a heart attack or
blood clots or damage. Yeah.
Yeah.
Although, you know, I could understand why somebody would immediately jump to the drowning conclusion. But the thing about it was, is he was healthy, but he's probably fairly healthy.
That, and that's my hard part with the, he fell in the mud.
And he couldn't get out.
And
so what would incapacitate somebody? Well, maybe a heart attack, you know, and, or stroke.
Yeah.
You know,
thank you.
Yeah.
That's why I look at something else that's got to have debilitated him. Because if you have a stroke or you're in the throes of a heart attack, your body is not going to respond. And as I said before, if you're even partially in the water, you're going to breathe it in, then you're going to drown.
It also, those also,
a terrible way to go.
Maybe lend a little more credence to the fact that he did try to contact his wife. You know, the other theories that we've talked about, we say he was hallucinating, he was in delirium, but people who are having these really huge psychotic breaks don't necessarily text their significant other and say, I'm lost in the middle of the woods.
Mm.
You probably don't contact them, or you say,
you don't
like,
think about it.
Or you say, you know, ah, the mushrooms are coming for me, or like something, right? I mean, you're not going to say very calmly, hey, I'm lost in the woods. And granted, I haven't seen the text, so I don't know exactly what his demeanor was, but it would also lead credence to, you know, a heart attack or something where you say, okay, I was just getting out and this happened, or you maybe had a heart attack and then a stroke.
That's the problem with text messages.
I'm sorry.
The tone is stripped away. That's why simple text messages can cause giant controversy because of the fact that you don't know which way they're meant to go. I am lost does not say angrily, I'm lost, or panicky, oh my god, I'm lost. I mean, that doesn't come through.
But none of those are hallucinatory reactions.
True.
That is a strange thing. I mean, you know, here he does this movie thing, which is get off the bus, and then he does a rational thing, which is send a text to his wife.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I don't know if he was fading in or out or what. I mean, obviously, if he was having a stroke or having something was going wrong, staying on the bus and telling the driver to go faster probably would have been a better solution.
It was another 4 to 6 hours to the destination.
Or telling him to turn around.
Oh, you're saying go faster so I can get to help.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's only a 54-minute drive or something like that, according to Google, which probably on a bus is probably like an hour and something drive from point A to point B in the town El Rosario or wherever it was that they were close to. It's not that long, so they were pretty dang close. It would have been easy for him to say, I think something's wrong with me. Get me a doctor.
But it could have also... My point was he may have said, oh my God, something's wrong. Get me to Mexico City now, is the way I was saying. So Joe says make the bus go faster, so he doesn't know El Rosario's there. He may not realize.
But usually you would say, I don't feel good. I need a doctor. And they would just find a hospital or something, right? As a good bus driver. You wouldn't just say, okay, cool, get off right here.
Then here's my catchphrase, rational thinking.
I'm on your side on that.
Okay.
I think, you know, I know enough about first aid and what people go through first aid care in general, emergency care, and what people go through with heart attacks, with strokes, with things of that nature.
Mm-hmm.
And the reaction is escape. Just get out of.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things they tell you to look for in situations like that is.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
If someone's nervous and agitated, it's a huge sign that something's going wrong inside their body and that you should get them emergency care as soon as possible administer emergency care.
So he stumbles around in the darkness, falls into a mud puddle, and having a heart attack, stroke, dies, and that's it.
Yeah.
Are we in consensus here?
I'm not locked into what caused it. I think that he had either a stroke or a heart attack.
Or an accident.
But I don't know what caused him to end up in the water. That's my problem, is that I see one of those as leading him there, but I don't know why it came about. And maybe it is just one of those damn random things. So I don't know that we're in consensus, because I'm not even settled
on... You're not even in consensus with yourself?
No, as usual.
Yeah.
Yeah, hard to say. Did his family ever raise a stink about this? Anybody raise any suspicions?
No.
Yeah.
No, I mean, his wife, you know, she had him cremated. They had a ceremony. There was a bajillion luchadors there. Black Abyss, his career, kind of ended after that. He tried to go on and take over the mantle of Abismo Negro. That didn't go on. He was going to go as Abismo Negro 2. That didn't work. Like, I mean, but that was it. I mean, there's this whole weird thing in the Luchador Society